Hey guys, Greg here with Brentzler Productions, bringing you another live sound how-to video today. This video is in conjunction with some questions we have gotten since our last set of videos we put out, people wanting us to do videos on other things. The last couple of videos I put out were the last two I put out were a couple of Pro Tools screenshot videos. One was over compression, about 40 minutes long. The other one was over how to use a noise gate. It was about 30 minutes long. But the last live videos we put out with the camera were over Audio 101 for live sound. It's a four video set on our page. Altogether, it's about 2.5 hours worth of video. And I kind of went through all the system components you need for a moderate size PA system for guys wanting to upgrade further from just a powered mixer with some speakers on stands or something like that. So I went through all the kind of different components you need for a system. So this video is going to expand on that. I've been trying to find time to film this video, but we've had a very busy last month we're finishing up with here. Shows. We had about 15 shows at our venue that we work at for our full-time job this month. Lots of local shows. Some of the bigger names we just worked with was Garbage and Stephen Lynch and a new group, Adrenaline Mob, which is a kind of a super group, I guess you could call it. It's a guitar player from Symphony X, the drummer from Dream Theater, Mike Portnoy, and the bass player from Disturbed. So a couple big names coming up next month that we get to work with is Cheap Trick and the Black Crows. And then we got some other shows coming up in June and July. July we have Johnny Lang and Buddy Guy playing together. So really cool blues show coming up. So we got some big names coming our way at our pro venue job that we work at. So I'm trying to squeeze in some more how-to videos for you guys out there. So thanks for checking out this one. And what we're going to do today is we're going to go over how to use external effects gear or a effects rack equipment, reverb units, delays, things like that. So this video will be in addition to all the other live sound stuff I have done. And we're going to get started with showing you what the gear is and some of the different options you have in gear. We're going to talk about how to patch that into your mixer, how to get sound into that effects unit, how to return it back to the mixer, and then give you a couple of different ideas and options you could do with that processing and a couple of different methods you can set up for some different types of effects or if you have some limited functions on your mixer, some ways to help you get around some of those limited functions to still produce a nice product and a great show quality without spending lots and lots of money. The whole point behind Brentzler Productions, the company and the page, is to show you guys how to make a good product and create a good product with the minimal amount of money without having to spend $10,000 to $20,000 buying equipment. So first thing we're going to do is we're going to introduce you to external rack gear. Okay, so the piece of rack gear that I am using for my effects processing is the M1 by TC Electronics. This one is a dual effects processor, so it's a dual engine, so you can run two separate effects at once. And basically with dual engines, what you can do most of the time is you can run them in series together where you can have like a delay and then a reverb and the outputs, or you can have channel one input as one effect and two as a separate, so you have two independent outputs. Or you can also, if you only have one send to send to a to the processor, if you only have one auxiliary send, and we'll talk about that in a minute. It can take one signal coming in, split it to both engines, and do two separate effects that way as well. So some different routing options with M1 and most dual engines. You can do some stuff like that. Some other pieces of rack gear out there, they go way up in price, past like the Behringer series. I think they have two effects processors that are around $200. The M1 usually goes for around $300. You can find them used on eBay sometimes for maybe $150 if you get lucky. But from there, they just get more expensive, close to, you know, $500, $600, $800, $1,000, $2,000 for effects processors. So they just get simple stuff that you just want to do some reverb and delay with and some basic effects processing and don't need all that super high grade $2,000 studio gear, I suggest the Behringer ones are good. I think they're only a single effect though, so you can only do one effect at once. Or the M1 is another great device. I believe Alesis has some other ones. I don't know every make and model of processing gear out there, so just shop around and in the price range you want to look at and find out, you know, what you like. So I'm just going to show you the basics of what you can do with any piece of gear, and so that is the point of the video today, is just to get you used to what the gear is and how to get signal to it and return out. Okay, we're now at the mixer, and this will be the beginning of the signal flow. And just to show you what we're using, it's just a simple Behringer mixer. This one has 8 microphone ends. You might have something like this, maybe bigger. It could be Yamaha, it could be a Mackie, another Behringer, a bigger Behringer. Whatever you're using, it doesn't matter. The signal flow is going to be the same. So, talk about the effects processing for a second. Generally, effects are usually stereo effects. And so this is what actually adding those reverbs and things is what gives you your stereo imaging in a stereo space if you're running a left-right PA system, or of course if you're doing recording and things and you're mixing, you have your left and right monitors. Reverb can help you add space to your mix across the stereo plane. It can also make the room sound like it's bigger than what it is. So that's kind of the point of reverb, so everything isn't so what's referred to as dry, where it's just you just hear the natural instruments and the vocals and things, but there's not a lot of ambience through the room. So reverb will do that for you. So getting into a reverb unit, traditionally, like if you're doing stuff in Pro Tools or whatever, a lot of times people set up stereo sends to the actual unit, so you actually send it a left-right signal. And the effects processors, when it comes to outboard gear, has a left-right in, or sometimes it'll just be N1 and N2. The problem is with those, unless you're working with a pretty high-end console that has multiple effects sends to use or multiple auxiliary sends, you really don't have the number of auxes to send, a left and a right to every single piece of effects gear you have. So a lot of boards like this one might only have 3. And so in this board, and what a lot of other boards will have, maybe yours has a couple more. This one has 2 that are pre-post selectable and 1 that is post-send. So and that's post-fader and pre-fader. So if you don't know what that means, is pre-fader means no matter what your fader position is doing, so you have your fader here and your channel, means these levels will not change with this fader adjustment. Post-send, or post-fader, means that the volume will be affected by the position of this fader. So you have an amount of send dialed in on the auxiliary send, but it will get louder as you push your fader up and get quieter as you pull your fader back. So the reason that effects are mixed on auxiliary buses and not just plugged into your left-right. You know, I've seen this done wrong before, where somebody just patched their main left-right out of their mixer into a reverb unit and then onto the rest of your signal chain. That is incorrect. And the reason why is because effects are meant to be mixed with wet and dry signals. So what that means is you have all your dry signals in your mixer. So this is like what's on your channel fader. So all of your instruments coming in that are non-affected, they're not being processed yet by the reverb or delay or whatever you're doing. Wet is the affected signal coming back from that device, whether it's reverb or delay or chorus or whatever. And you have to mix those wet and dry signals together to your main bus to create your overall mix. So the reason they're done on auxiliary sends is so you can dial in the individual level per channel and per instrument or vocal or whatever it would be to that effect send. So you dial in individual send levels off those auxiliaries. So you want to use post-fade auxiliary sends. And the reason why is because if you're running an effect in pre-fade and you're making adjustments, say in my vocal mic here up and down, I need my effect to get quieter when I bring this channel down. If I had it in pre-fade, if I brought this all the way down, my vocal would still be coming through that reverb and back to my main bus as just a reverb signal. So it would sound like it was in a subway tunnel or underwater or something. You'd hear just a really big echo sound. And so you don't want just that reverb to come through by itself. So you want your levels to adjust up and down with your fader. As it gets louder, it sends a little bit more send, so it balances out. That way you're not have to constantly adjust the send levels on all of your on your sends on your individual channels. You should be able to
set the SIM level to whatever your preference is, how much signal of each instrument you want going to your effects processor, and you shouldn't have to touch it through most of the show. So when you're mixing on your faders and things like this, bringing them up and down, your effects are going to go with that same SIM level. So it'll keep your mix tightened together, so you don't have to readjust everything all the time. And that is a little different than your effects return, so I'll talk about that in a second. So on this board, I'll go back to this again, now that we have talked about what auxiliary SINs are for and the difference between pre and post, is a lot of boards you might only have three or four. So in this one, as I said, I have two that are in pre, and these are for monitor SINs, so I have a mix one and a mix two monitor SIN. Then I have a third one, and this one is actually labeled effects because the auxiliary three on this one actually is internally bused to an onboard effects processor, which is up here. So a lot of smaller consoles or lower end consoles will have onboard effects. If you're just starting out, go ahead and use those if you just want a basic reverb. But if you're wanting to break into the world of more customized effects and way more different sounds and stuff that you can adjust yourself, that is why you buy external rack gear. Secondly, the onboard effects usually aren't all that great sounding. Depending on the make and manufacturer of the board. Behringer's, their older ones kind of sound like crap, their effects. The board itself is actually pretty decent. I'm not a Behringer basher. I actually support their gear. A lot of people just hate their stuff. I like it because it can get the job done. You don't have to spend all the money in the world buying equipment. When the band you're mixing is probably not a pro band anyway. So, you know, in my work, my pro venue that I work at, we've got roughly $1 million worth of sound, and I still mix bands that sound like crap, and they don't sound any better. If it's a band that doesn't sound all that great, even $1 million sound system is not going to make them sound any better. So you can use cheaper gear, and as long as it's heard and mixed well, your job is done. Your job is not, as an engineer, is not to make their instruments in tune or make the vocal actually have singing talent. Your job is to make it mixed and be able to hear. And Behringer can do that for you just fine. So I support their gear, but their effects are not all that great on onboard ones. They're newer ones now that they have acquired Clark Technic. They're starting to put Clark Technic effects, so I imagine they will sound a lot better in those new Xenic series they're releasing with Clark Technic. But anyway, so if you have onboard effects, you know, go ahead and use those if you're just starting out. If you don't, you won't even have to worry about it. So what this third auxiliary is going to do on this channel is it automatically will send to that if you don't patch anything out of its output. So you might have ones that are labeled effects, even though you don't have it. Some boards just actually put effects in because they're a post-fade, or it just might say auxiliary 3, 4, 5, 6, whatever you have. So how we route to the effects is we're going to be using this auxiliary 3 output. So on your board, if you're top mount or maybe on the back, depending on what you have, you're going to have, usually this board is all a quarter inch up here, you're going to have some outputs that says aux send or effects outs or auxiliary bus out, something of that nature. So on this board, you see I have 1, 2, 3 and effects. So we're not going to use effects. What the effects does, usually, depending on the mixer, most of them it will do this. If you have an onboard effects processor, the effects is a mixed output of that. So this is actually sending that wet effect signal out of your processor, out of that plug. So we don't want to send that already affected signal into our effects processor. So we're going to use auxiliary 3. So 1 and 2 would go to my monitor, so 3 is the output to send to that. So I have over here, this is what's called a cable HOD. I've showed this in some of my other videos. On my Streamline Your Gear video, I showed how to make these. In my other ones, I always promote stuff like this. Quick, simple method here is I have a send and two returns coming from the effects processor. And instead of having to run each individual cables, I have them electrical taped every foot and a half or so. So this stays in the back of my rack all the time. They're labeled send, return 1 and 2. And this never leaves the rack. And then so I pull it out of the rack and it plugs right into my mixer. Save setup time and having to grab all those individual cables. So I take my send, is labeled N1 send, and this guy into auxiliary 3. Okay, so now we're sending into the reverb unit, or the effects unit. Now, I said earlier about the left-right going into the effects, you know, to give you the actual stereo input. And as I said, most people won't have that option because they're not going to have that many available auxiliaries. So what most effects units are set up to do is they can do a 1 and 2 out connection. And so basically the algorithms that are built into those effects units can take a single output like this, and it will input that into the unit, and it will do all of its processing and provide a stereo signal in that reverb space or chorus or whatever the effect is. It'll bring back a stereo send. So this is a pretty common method that's used in the smaller scale stuff, is a one in, two return. So we're going to start with that, stereo return for the first way to hook up a processor. So I have up here, your board should have some sort of stereo auxiliary returns, stereo aux returns, it might even say FX returns. So just look for those where they're labeled returns. So this one we'll use is this return one, and we'll use that first one. So I have output one is the left, and output two on mine are labeled, that is the right side coming out. So it's labeled left and right, or output one and two, depending on what model of processor you have. Could be labeled a couple different things. So with these returns and stereo returns on every console, they usually are just bused left to left, right to right, and those go directly to your main bus, and then you should have some sort of return for the volume of this incoming signal. So that is that wet signal now coming back from your effects processor into your console. And then so over here on the Behringer board, they have return one, two, and three is where they return to. Some boards will have a potentiometer like this. Some of them might actually have a fader for return. Other consoles can allow you to use your groups. Like this guy down here can actually be assigned to one of those returns, so you can have it on a fader. So read the manual and look at the controls on your board, how to get that return back for that that volume control. So we are on this top one here on effects one. So what we're going to do now is we will test the connection. So we have signal coming out of our board out of a post fade auxiliary send. That's one output. We are now returning on a stereo return, left and a right, from the processor. So we'll bring the fader up on the mic. And we're going to dial in our effects send on aux 3 at its unity setting. So for vocals, I like to send the vocal to be processed the most into the effects unit. So I usually put my sends at 0. If you had some other stuff that you didn't want as much effect on, you could just dial in wherever you want it. So from all the way off to wherever you prefer. So I set my vocals at unity. You don't have to do it that way, but that's what I do to send into the effects unit, and then we'll adjust the return as it comes back through process. So first we're going to check and make sure it's coming into the processor. So we'll check over here real quick. Check, 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 and there you go. You see it's coming in the left and the right. So as I said, it takes the one input and it will put it to both its bus and the effects processor. Check, 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 one T. So you see we have two coming in there. Okay. So now what we're gonna do is it will power the amps on real quick. Okay, so now we got the amp on and we have the fader up. Check one T. So you should hear it. One T coming through the PA system. One, two, check. And so that is the dry signal. And so what we're gonna do is we'll go over to that return now. And I've just got this on a hall reverb. It's a pretty good size one, just so you can hear the effect coming in. Check two, two, one, two, one, two. It won't just make it really obvious. So there you go, now you can hear the reverb. Two, one, two, coming in, and that's just barely bringing this guy up at all. Two, check, one, two, check, stand out in front of it. One, two, check, one, two. So that's a little more natural, maybe for a big reverb, for a ballad or something, or whatever you want to use it for. So they hear both the dry and the wet mix coming through. And that's what you do with that send. and a return. So with your return, you just bring in the amount of signal from that reverb to mix it with the original dry vocal channel. So this first method, just having the stereo left, right, returning in, works fine if you just want to use an all-around reverb or a general effect that you want to apply to everything. So you would go to your individual channels down here and dial in, like on your other vocals or maybe your drum channels, your snare and your overheads, or if you have toms or how big of an input list you're using. You send everything, however much level you want of each instrument, to that reverb, and then bring in the reverb on your return. And then so that works just for a general reverb or a general effect for everything. Problem is, you're limited to just that one effect, so you just have the one reverb. So if you're doing it that way, you have no extra delay or anything else, unless you had a second rack unit. So if you had two units, then you can have one as a reverb, one as a delay. And so something you could do, so if you have a board that has more effect sends, more auxiliaries, then the best way is to send each auxiliary to each piece of rack gear. But if you only have one effects unit, and there's a limitation to this as well, you are have to cut out using a stereo effect return, so you're limited there on the second method. And what we're going to do is these ones that actually up here, if you can see, are labeled mono on the left. So you can take a stereo return, and if you just plug one return into it, it just makes it mono, and we'll send it to both buses evenly. So we're going to take our second return, and we are going to go into another effects return. So that guy was up there on that second one there. So what we're going to do now is we have, this is the option that you can do if you have a dual engine like the M1, is you have one effect coming in on return one, one effect coming in on return two. So we're still sending out of auxiliary three. So there's one input going into the M1 effects processor from the vocal channel. So the level's still the same. I still have this unity. And what I can do is on this guy, I have a user preference set up, and so you can go into these dual engine mode on this, and so we'll go here to factory user, and so I set one up here, 14, there it is. So what this is a tap delay and a small hall reverb. So this is in a dual mono routing, is what this is doing. So each effects engine is working by itself, but it's still sharing that same return coming in. So what I have is a tap delay, so you actually have tap tempo, so you can match the beat of the song that the band is playing. So your delay matches their tempo. So you have tap delay coming in on one, and a hall coming in on the other. So if we grab the mic real quick, check, check. This is the dry signal, check, check. You still see that one input is sending to both the left and the right input. So what we'll do, we go over here, check, check. One, two, one, two, one, two, one, two, one, two, one, two. I have a delay. Two, and now I have a reverb. Check two, and that's on the second. So then I can keep that reverb up, and go throughout the song, and then just bring in delay. Check.
Check. Check.
Wherever it fits in the song. So you could just ride that delay up and down. To just bring it in whenever you need it. So one more disadvantage of this, obviously, as I said, you no longer have stereo effects, but for some bar show type situations, you're in a small room, you could sacrifice not having stereo effects. You still have stereo panning done by your pan on your console, so like your overheads and guitars and vocals, you could still park them around where you want in your mix with your pan. Your effects would just be given ambience, and you know, you could have the delay and the special effects and stuff being in a mono return So you lose, you sacrifice your stereo mix from the reverb, but you have multiple effects. But one other problem with this is if you wanted to send other items to it, it would not work quite as well. And the problem is, because as I said, I'm using that one send, so let's say I have my vocal up and I wanted to send my snare drum just to the reverb, it won't work this way, because since it's sharing that same send, if I turn aux 3 up on my snare, it's still going to send to the delay and the reverb, because I'm sharing that send to it. So the effects processor is taking that send, sending it to both effects engines, so it's going to the delay and the reverb, and returning as separate auxiliaries, separate auxiliary returns. So my snare drum would be coming through the delay as well, or overheads, or whatever else you send to it. So you sacrifice being able to do extra stuff with that. So if you just wanted to affect your vocals, this would work to have a reverb and a separate delay, but everything else you send down that signal is also going to be delayed as well. So obviously you really don't want snare drum and overheads and things coming in as a delay. So once again, this method works if you just wanted to do vocal effects and you wanted to have a reverb and a delay, which you can get away with depending on the room you're in as well, because you know, maybe the drums would sound okay in the room you're in and you really just want to give that extra ambience for effect for smaller show situations to your vocals. So this is one way you can do it with one send and one effects unit, is having those two separate engine returns. So just to recap on the different methods, obviously the best way is to have the stereo effects, so you could do one send with a stereo effect, and then if you have a console that has more outputs that you can use a second auxiliary send to another piece of rack gear, so you have independent verb and delay or chorus or whatever other special effect you want, have two separate independent units with two separate auxiliary sends. Another way around that is having two effects units use the same auxiliary send, but you can split the output to send to both. Or the very last method, and probably the least preferred, is that it's through a dual mono setup where you have a dual engine effects processor, you send it one signal, and you return two separate effects on two separate returns that you can control independently. So it really just depends on how advanced you want your system to be, the amount of money you want to spend on getting multiple effects processors, and things of that nature. So that all just depends on how complicated your system you want it to be, and how much money you spend. So there's all the different options there for effects on different choices you can work with. I hope I covered all the details you're wanting to know when it comes to patching outboard effects gear. So if you like this video, check out the rest of the videos on our page. Most of them are like this. They're pretty detailed, and I try to explain every step of the way of how to get to point A to point B and all the way back around. So check out the rest of our videos. And also, one last note, I talked about how busy we were this last month in the beginning of the video. If you are subscribed to Front of House magazine, it's a free magazine dealing all with live sound. They have a about the center of the magazine, they usually do a showcase show, and they do a little concert, just overviews really of, they show a picture and what the venue was and what gear they were using. Check out the April edition as soon as it's released. My work is in there, and I'm featured in that as a front of house engineer. I just list your names and all the gear you have in your venue. So look for Voodoo Lounge in the April edition of Front of House magazine, and it was for a Journey tribute band that we did. So that's kind of cool to see that, and see your venue and your name in an audio magazine. So go check that out, and just for the subscribe to the magazine, it lets you know all the stuff going on in the pro world. It's not really showing that much consumer gear. It's a lot of the pro industry stuff, so you can learn the pro industry equipment and things and the shows that are out there. So I suggest you subscribe to that. It's Front of House magazine. I believe it's Front of House Online is the website. If you just Google Front of House, you should be able to find the magazine website link on Google, and then subscribe to get the actual physical paper magazine. It also comes in electronic form, and I think there's an app for the iPhone and Android as well for that magazine. So check out the rest of our videos. If you want to see any other things done, send us an email. If you have a question about something, you can write that question in the comment. But if there's another video you would like to see of something explained, email it to us or post it in one of the comments, and we'll try to make a video for you. Secondly, today I'm going to also film a crossover video. We had a question from a viewer about problems with their crossover and setting proper crossover settings. So after this video, I am going to do one on crossovers. So look for that video as well. And that was from a viewer wanting to find out more information. So that's what we're going to do.
For how-to videos, project ideas, and tricks of the trade, check out the Brinster Productions channel on YouTube. Real production advice from working professionals in the sound and lighting industry.